Hey, this is Butch Walker, and you're listening to Walking the Floor.
I'm walking the floor over you.
Walking the floor.
I'm walking the floor.
Walking the floor over you.
Hola, señores and señoritas. This is Chris Shiplett. And you are listening to the greatest goddamn podcast in the world, Walking the Floor. It is a beautiful summer day here in London. I'm sitting in my hotel room and I can hear the people milling about on the street. They're buzzing. London is abuzz with summertime joy. It's been a heat wave. And tomorrow's Glastonbury. So you know Glastonbury. It's the big time festival over here and it's going to be my first time there. So I'm just saying it better be effing amazing. I'm sure it will be. It's going to be great. As you're probably aware, all of the Foo Fighters stuff that I've been lying about while I've been doing press these last few months to promote my own little solo record and pretending there's like nothing going on in Foo Fighter land, all of that information was released the other day. So it's good. I don't have to be a liar anymore. Or I don't have to be as much of a liar. Which is always nice. It was hard. It's tough doing all that promo around my record. And, you know, every interview they go, what's going on with Foo Fighters? Oh, I don't know. You know, nothing. Nothing much. Just kind of hanging around. Blah, blah, blah. Anyway, that's all out there. And tomorrow we're playing Glastonbury. And we've been over here for the last week or so doing shows. And it's been great. I've had some really fun stuff. We had one of my musical heroes, Michael Monroe. Former lead singer from the band Hanoi Rocks, that is a hugely, hugely important band to me, came up and did a bunch of songs with us in Helsinki. That was amazing. I interviewed him that day, so that's coming soon. A Walk in the Floor exclusive interview with Mr. Michael Monroe. Then we went to Riga. It's great. I'd never been to Riga, Latvia. Walked around, saw the town. Before all that, we were in Iceland, which was beautiful as always. And here we are now in London. It's a little weird. I don't have any like solo shows or any of that kind of junk to hype. It's like the first time in a while I've got nothing going on that front. So I don't know. Go listen to the record. Go listen to some old Walk on the Floor stuff. There's got to be something I can hype, right? Maybe I can hype some gear. Oh, and thanks to everybody for sending me all the suggestions for how to properly amplify your acoustic guitar. Some of those I've tried, some of those I haven't. I don't know. Still always sounds like shit to me, but that's just me. That's just my ear. Maybe your ear's hearing something different. Maybe I'm using the stuff wrong. I don't know. But I'll tell you what I've been using a lot lately since we're doing a little gear talk. Gear talk on the old Walk on the Floor. Gear roundup. I have been using that Klon KTR pedal in front of my AC30. I set the AC30 to a light distortion, not a ton of distortion, just a little bit of gain on it. And then I put that Klon KTR pedal that's supposedly like more or less the same thing as the Klon Centaur. I mean, it's different. I don't know. I don't get into all that stuff. But those Klon Centaurs are worth like thousands of dollars, and you can find a KTR for a few hundred bucks. So I would suggest you go with the KTR unless you got that extra cash. And if you do have that extra cash, buy me one too, because I wouldn't mind to hear what those sound like. I don't think I've ever used an actual Klon Centaur, but the Klon KTR pedal is amazing for overdrive. If you need to overdrive your gear and you got a few hundred bucks burning a hole in your pocket, then get yourself a Klon KTR pedal. My only complaint about them, not clearly marked on the face of it, like what's the volume and what's the gain and all that stuff, but whatever. I just marked it myself. There is a cute little note on there that says, kindly remember, the ridiculous hype that offends so many is not of my making. Which I guess is the guy that makes them waves telling everyone to fuck off and stop hyping it so much. And I think there are many clone copycats as well, so whatever. Get a KTR, see what it does for you. All right, let's sell some music gear. Let me tell you about my good friends over at Zounds.com. Did you know that instead of paying full price all at once, you can own the gear you've been dreaming of right now and pay monthly? There's no reason to wait anymore. And Zounds will ship your gear immediately right after your first payment, and they never charge interest, ever. Zounds.com, where every person you talk to is a real musician. Let's get on over to the interview. Come on. Okay, so a few months back, I was supposed to interview producer slash singer-songwriter slash motorcycle enthusiast Butch Walker. And we just couldn't get our schedules to jive. And, like, my people were dealing with his people. And, like, my people would email me. And then I'd go back with some dates that worked for me. But we were in the middle of recording the Foo Fighters record, so that was kind of tricky. And he was busy working on stuff, so his thing was tricky. And after, like, several back and forths, it just never happened. And it just kind of fell by the wayside, right? So fast forward to a couple months down the road. I'm up in beautiful Ojai, California for the weekend with my wife, having a nice romantic getaway. And I walk into this cool store. And who's standing right there? But it's Mr. Butch Walker. I almost asked him if he had, like, a shirt in my size. Cause I thought, like, at first I thought he was just a dude that worked there. And then quickly my mind went, oh, shit, that's Butch Walker. And so we had a nice little conversation. I hit him up. I said, you know, I think I was supposed to interview you. And he's like, oh, yeah, let's do it. So then we go back to our hotel. And, of course, he's staying at the same hotel with his wife and son. And at that point, I kind of felt like I was, like, stalking him. Like, oh, it's me again. Hey, want to do that interview? Anyway, a couple weeks later, we finally got the interview done. Turns out, me and Butch Walker have a lot of common ground musically, especially in our youths when we were heavy metal, rock and roll, guitar player dudes and all that sort of thing. So we had a great talk over at his studio in Santa Monica about everything from, like, how he started playing music in the first place to, like, moving out to California to make it in the late 80s, you know, Sunset Strip scene, to, like, then how he got into producing. And, you know, this is a guy that produces all kinds of bands, punk rock bands, big, huge pop artists, and everything in between, as well as being a solo artist in his own right. And, you know, the trials and tribulations of touring and getting his music out and, you know, developing a fan base and all that stuff. So I hope you dig it. This is Mr. Butch Walker on Walking the Floor. Hey, you scream, engineering has never been my strong.
Dude, if you need any strength. Help with that stuff, I'm a total nerd.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, man, one of these days.
I mean, that's what I do.
I keep telling myself.
I was an engineer before I was a producer.
Oh, really? Is that how you got your start?
Well,
kind of into the, because I was going to get to that, but if we could just jump right in there.
We can get in there. That's fine.
Was that like, well, you know what? Actually, let's not start there. Let's, because I'm going to get to that eventually, but why don't we just start with your latest record?
Sure.
Which is named after a reference from, like, my favorite movie of all time.
One of my favorites too.
Yes,
and
The Outsiders.
Stay Gold. Yeah,
yes.
The Outsiders, and it was I hadn't seen that movie in a long time, and I watched it about a year ago again, revisited it. You know, mainly because, funny enough, I ended up connecting with the actual Pony Boy, C. Thomas Howell.
Really?
Yeah, he lives in Georgia, where I'm from. He's living in North Georgia in Ellijay, where some of my biker friends live.
Oh.
That they build custom motorcycles and stuff, and they're good friends with them, and literally. They ended up moving there, him and his wife. They moved there, and he's got, like, a full-on, like, white beard and kind of has a southern accent.
Are you
now.
Trying to tell me that Pony Boy did not stay gold?
He did not. But it was really crazy because we ended up hanging out all night and
how
just having
cool.
the best time. So I went back and revisited the movie and
yeah.
realized
was that one of your favorites from when you were a kid?
Yeah,
I think
totally.
We're about the same age. So
totally.
Because that
yeah,
was,
I'm 47.
I swear to God, that was, like, one of my, it's probably my favorite movie of all time.
It's great. And and just the amount of, like, star power in it is
yes.
insane.
Ridiculous. I mean, before they were all famous, too.
Yeah, you had, like, I mean, even before Tom Cruise explosion.
Yeah.
You know, like,
oh, yeah. Rob Lowe, Matt Dillon. I mean,
like,
it's
when
Patrick
Tom Cruise
Swayze.
Had one tooth in the middle.
Right
here. Yeah, right in
yeah,
the front.
Yeah.
But it was, and also probably questionably the worst Stevie Wonder song ever recorded.
Right, and so sort of at odds with the vibe of that movie.
I feel like he lost a bet.
Right. With, but it doesn't make any sense either.
Coppola? I feel like he lost a bet with him saying, you got to sing and record a song for me for this movie.
Yeah, but I wrote it. Yeah.
It's terrible.
It's terrible, yeah.
Stay gold. It's
but shouldn't it have been like a doo-wop song or a rockabilly song or something would have fit the vibe? I feel like that movie was a huge influence on my sort of taste in pop culture stuff.
It was. You know? It was. And it was just such a... I identified with it growing up, I think, as well, because I definitely was one of those kids. I was definitely one of the outsiders. I was one of the greasers. I was one of the, you know, not the popular rich kid like right. all the other boys, like Leif Garrett.
Right, yeah.
And all those guys. I grew up in a town called Cartersville, Georgia.
Mm.
And it
Is
was
that
north,
small?
North Georgia, yeah, right. Like kind of at the foothills of the mountains.
How real far from Atlanta?
Small, quiet.
Would like Atlanta have been like the city that you went to the big,
yeah,
you know,
an
big
hour
gigs
away.
And stuff in?
Yeah, an hour away. We were okay. not even a suburb then.
Right.
You know, we were just like pretty far removed from it. But it just really struck a chord with me that movie, and also just looking back on my childhood and on my youth, a lot of the experience for drawing for the lyrics on the new record.
Sure.
And I think a lot of that just ended up being it correlated, because I always felt like my audience too, I have a very awesome following, you know, of like, you know, they're really diehard, and I love that, and it's a beautiful thing to be able to go out and tour without, like, you know, having to worry about tour support or radio play or anything like that,
right.
And like fill a room everywhere I go,
right.
which
is very rare.
It is very rare, and business. I'm very lucky, and I feel very fortunate that I have what I like to call lifers, you know. And I feel like we're all the same people. Like they remind me a lot of the people that I grew up with, where I was kind of just, we were kind of like the island of misfit toys, you know. It was
right.
not the people that fit in, you know. I mean, and you know, your band's the same way. You guys have a lot of fans that are, it's very like blue collar. It's very, it's not like the popular like cheerleader. It's not that, you know.
Right, like we've never been the hippest band in the world.
Well, yeah.
You know? And you look at our crowd and it reflects
here.
It, you know.
Yeah, but that's why you're still around.
Right, exactly.
Because you would have been a fucking fad for 10 minutes if you were.
Sure, sure.
And that's why you're still around, and you guys are one of the legends, you know. And that being said, you know, on my little level of whatever semi-popularity, I like that fan base, and I like that I identify with them, and I kind of speak to them lyrically from that same place of, like, you know, not being picked first, you know, draft of dodgeball when they were in high school and middle school. And
just relived that recently.
You did?
Yeah, in a very odd way. I was taking my kids, I was at the park, my kids were taking some tennis lessons, and there was this family having this birthday party, right? And they started to put together a soccer game. And I was just standing there waiting for my kids, right? And one of them goes, hey man, you wanna play? I was like, sure. She goes, all right, come over. And they start picking teams. And I swear to God, I got picked last. This was like 2 weeks ago. And I still got picked last.
That's so weird. I feel that way all the time. If there's ever a sports ball put in front of me, I will definitely be last. And my kid's the same way. Yeah. He is exactly the same as me. He's like, he's a little kind of like, you know, kind of chunky kid who's like, who's very like, not very nimble. He's,
right,
he's all
right.
artistic.
Like, were you like that growing up? Were you always like you know, into music or into just...
Yeah.
Like, because it's funny, what you're saying is exactly what my family was like growing up. We didn't
sure.
follow sports. We were like music nerds. We weren't into anything else.
Well, I didn't grow up with either, unfortunately. I had to kind of find music because my mom played piano in the church. I didn't give a fuck about that, clearly. My dad, you know, God rest his soul, it would have told you he couldn't even play the radio good. That was, you know, he was funny, clearly, but he was not musically inclined. And I think just being able to find music like I had to find it back then, this was, you know, same with you, it was
pre-internet.
Pre-everything.
Yeah.
Pre-any information. Like,
yeah.
You had to dig for it. Like, it was, you know, I'd go to the record store.
Yeah.
And
the you got all the good recommendations from the weird
yeah.
dude at the record store, right?
All those movies are so valuable to me, like High Fidelity and all those. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
where,
yeah, sure.
Where you get like the people in there that they're the music snobs, or but they're just passionate,
right?
And they were also outcasts, and they were also outsiders, and so they took up that as a passion because they weren't going to be good at basketball or football, you know, quarterbacks. And that was kind of like where I felt like I identified. So I started, I begged my parents to take me to see Kiss when I was 8 years old in 1977. And that changed my world, changed my life.
You saw Kiss in 77?
77, the Love Gun tour.
Wow.
Yeah, first concert I'd ever seen. So like nothing else, everything paled in comparison.
I mean,
after
yeah,
that
must have been. I mean, until Kiss got back together in the reunion years,
yeah,
everything else must have paled in comparison. That's like an amazing first gig.
Oh
that's
yeah,
that's setting the bar very high.
It was very
for
high.
Showmanship.
Yeah, and it was so funny. My dad, you know, and I've told this story a lot, but it's always worth telling, especially if there's new people listening. But like, you know, my dad was not happy about, you know, going to this concert. He was like this beer drinking outlaw country listening, hell raising, you know, Southern boy, like to the hill, like right. Mountain man, grew up in Tryon, Georgia, which was Tater Hill, I believe was the name of his town. Not even potato. and he, you know, he was wearing this like new blazer, and he was probably younger. He was definitely younger than me now.
Right.
Then, and I was 8, and he was wearing like a leather blazer that his mom had gotten him for his birthday. And, you know, my dad looked like Kenny Rogers or something. Like he had the Waylon Jennings and had the beard back then and everything. And all these guys were dressed like Kiss in the audience.
Right.
Full tilt,
yeah, yeah.
You know, just like the movie Detroit Rock City when you see it. You
yeah,
know, it was
sure.
like beach balls flying everywhere, pot smoke just hazed everywhere. And I'd never smelled that before. It smelled incredible. I was like, what is that?
Right.
People are handing
you
it over.
You just know something bad's happening,
like the
but
church,
it's good.
You know, like the church lady Dana Carvey played? That was basically my mother, you know. And so they're passing it over my sisters. And it was just like, I was like scared to death, but in the best way. I was
yeah.
like, this is frightening and awesome, and I want to.
So you're there with your whole family?
My whole family.
That's amazing.
My mom and dad took us because I begged and pleaded. I was like, I don't want anything for Christmas or my birthday. Just get tickets to this concert. I saw Alex Cooley come on a commercial on public access TV in my bedroom, saying we're bringing Kiss to the Omni in Atlanta. You know how they used to always show those concert, those
yeah,
promo
yeah, sure.
promo ads. And I was like, oh my god, I have to see this. And and I just remember the lights went out, and this guy dressed like Gene Simmons kept like spilling beer on the back of my dad's seat, and my dad was getting really pissed. And you know, the lights were strobing, and the music was super loud. I couldn't hear from all the screaming, and I just looked over, and my dad was like turned around and like choking Gene Simmons out for like spilling beer all over him.
Oh, really?
It was just like, and we left during the encore because my dad thought it was over. And it was a typical parent
right,
move. Like,
right.
Show's
yeah,
over.
Done.
Let's get the fuck out of
yeah.
here.
Let's you know? Beat traffic.
Let's get out of here. Yeah, beat traffic. Yeah, but it was still like the most amazing experience, and I remember that being the pivotal moment in my life, even at 8 years old, because, you know, most people go through life not knowing what the hell they want to do.
Sure.
I knew from the time I was 8 years old.
Really?
And I never...
I mean, were you already playing guitar or playing any instrument
I was,
at that point?
I was playing drums. So I had a drum kit, and I was kind of good. I could hold a beat down okay, but,
right.
there was, you know, there was nobody to play with
right.
in Cartersville. Cartersville was like, you know... It was, like I said, it was football players and deer hunters.
Did you have, like, and siblings that played or anything?
My sisters liked rock and roll, and I definitely got a little bit of my education through
older
their
sisters?
Record collections. Yeah, two older sisters.
Okay.
But we never played music together because they didn't play. They played in marching band, you know, in school.
Right,
and, but
right.
they never really took up, like, any, like, contemporary instruments, you know. And I wanted to switch to guitar because I didn't like sitting. So I switched to guitar and started taking lessons and... just basically soaking in everything. And then MTV happened in 1980, and that gave me a reason to run home from school every day and turn it on and just watch music videos. Cause
totally. Like you didn't know how good early MTV was at the time. Like, cause
no.
most of the stuff I wanted to listen to was like, you know, I wanted to hear Ozzy and Van Halen and
yeah.
stuff, which is great. And they would show some of that stuff, but you had to sit through like, the Buggles and you know,
yeah, which is the
early
first video,
Madonna,
yeah.
Yeah. Whoever, you know, was
yeah.
all this great other stuff.
Yeah.
That you would sit there and watch, and I'd like bands that I would have never been turned on to or
totally.
Would have never have chosen to listen to wound up becoming like a meaningful influence
well,
because of it.
You know, and I feel like what that does is I feel like that paved the way for my career now. I
right.
feel like it paved the way for me to be able to produce all these different styles of music because it didn't tell me when I was that young, there was no scene. There was nothing in Cartersville of a clique of people saying,
right.
you can't listen to that. You can't like Asia. You can't like, you know, Motley Crue. You can't like, you know, Def Leppard.
God, I
you
wish I had
like
that
the
because
Cure.
I had older brothers and my older brother's friends that very much
strictly
had rules.
You yeah. could,
if you were even within rock, and we were like heavy metal, you know, classic rock kids, and like even within that, there were certain bands that, you know, were less cool than other, you know what I mean? Like, there was,
oh, yeah.
very, it was very like specific.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean,
so
I
the
just,
point that I would have to hide records from my brothers because I would fear them, like, you know, making fun of me for
I
having
just got
it.
Lucky with that because, like I said, I was kind of an outcast and there was nobody else really with an opinion because nobody else, music was like rock and roll was kind of Footloose vibes, you know,
right.
because rock and
right.
roll was kind of shunned in a conservative Bible Belt town like that when,
yeah.
in the 80s, 70s and 80s. So I had like two friends, this kid Kelly and this kid Andy, who were my best friends all through grade school. Kelly, still to this day, we still, you know, get drunk and text each other on Friday nights and sing Van Halen lyrics, you know, just, you know, to each other through the phone.
Sure.
And it was like early Van Halen records, the Kiss records, all that stuff, Def Leppard, all those records were like, you know, really huge for me because there was nobody in town getting to listen to it. The
right.
kids weren't really getting to listen to that kind of stuff. So there was only about like a half a dozen kids I would gravitate and find. And then, you know, my sister had a boyfriend who was, you know, he was a couple of years older than me, and he was the kid with the blacklight posters all in his room and life-size posters of Blue Oyster Cult, Rush. All of a sudden, that was what another pivotal moment was. I traded him my Love Gun album for the Van Halen 1 album.
Ooh, yeah.
Which I'd never heard Van Halen. When I got that and put it on, I was like, this is like outer
like
space
a step
music.
Step up in intensity.
A step up in everything.
Isn't
musicianship.
Isn't it funny? Like, when I was a kid, Kiss records sounded like Slayer records to me.
It was and so was, heavy and
you know,
fierce
yeah,
sounding
totally.
To
and
us. Yeah.
There was a point in adult life where I went back and listened to them and realized, like, wow, that's like good time boogie woogie rock and roll. I mean, I love them, don't get me wrong, but like my perception of those records as a kid was very different than the
it,
reality
it was,
of them.
It was scarier.
Right, yes.
It was
yes.
it was reckless and
yeah.
scary, but when you go back and listen to them now, it's just like, no, they were just like copying Alice Cooper and the Beatles and
right.
you know,
yeah,
stuff
yeah,
like
yeah.
that, which good on them for
yeah.
that, you know. But I kind of look at that as like, it was the building blocks, you know?
Yeah.
Like when I got that Van Halen record and heard real like crazy prowess on guitar,
yeah.
drums and bass, that was huge for me. That's
mm.
really turned up the notch for me, like to get in there and learn guitar.
Well,
and,
what, how did you do that in you know, small town Georgia? Was there like the local Shredder guy that taught
there
lessons
was.
At the local shop
there was
kind
a,
of thing?
Yeah, there's a local Shredder. He was a Jehovah's Witness, and you know, he was allowed to you know, get in there and in his dad's work shed
mm.
and teach guitar lessons, you know, all week to make a living.
Mm.
And he was super important for me, this guy, Chris. He knew like every Van Halen riff.
Right.
Everything he wore, every guitar, every amp, he pinstriped them. Everything.
Of course
he was
did.
Already out of high school. So you know, to me, he was like, oh, this guy's cool. He's like,
yeah.
he's already out of high school.
Yeah.
You know, it's total Wooderson vibes, you know?
Sure.
And, but like, he was so nice and so patient. And it was the first time I'd taken a lesson where what they didn't try to fucking make me learn Camptown Races and Coming
right.
Around the Mountain,
yeah.
you know, from a Mel Bay book. And
God,
I didn't, you know,
it's,
nobody
it's so
wants
funny. I relive that with my own kids, watching them go through ups and downs with their music lessons. It's so dependent on whether or not you give a shit about the thing that you're learning.
Yeah.
You know?
Of course. And like, that was the beauty of it, is this guy was like, I was like, play Eruption again. And
right.
I'd just sit and watch him.
Yeah.
And half of that was learning, just watching.
Sure.
I was just watching him and picking up on the technique, because I never had that. I mean, you know, we had a rock station called 96 Rock that barely came in on the radio from Atlanta.
Mm.
And then I had MTV finally. And so the little, or Don Kirshner's rock concert
right,
on Friday nights
yeah,
and
sure.
shit. So it was like whatever I could see, American Bandstand even, like anywhere I could see somebody playing an electric guitar was fascinating to me. Like, you know,
right.
you'd see a clip of the Bay City Rollers playing on the Muppet Show. Muppet Show was a huge
Alice Cooper was
influence.
On the Muppet Show. Yeah,
Elton
totally.
John, everybody, Buddy Rich,
yeah.
motherfucker, like everybody great was on the Muppet Show, and it was
yeah.
a puppet show.
yeah.
And it was one of the most influential things for my childhood musically, because
yeah.
they were super in tune with that. They made it seem cool and acceptable to want to be a rock star and be in a rock band and play music. The Monkees, same thing, another
right.
like fabricated TV show was huge for me. My first record ever was the Monkees' Greatest Hits. I bought it off TV for $4.99 because I watched the show religiously when I was like 7 years old.
Well, when did you transition from being, you know, a music student to actually going out and performing and being in bands?
So by the time I was, maybe 11 or 12, I was starting to get offers to be in bands around town of like older guys.
Right.
Because there was, it was Slim Pickens in Cartersville. So the fact that they had to find an 11-year-old to play drums, right, that's pretty bad.
Right.
Or like guitar. And I would just kind of like fumble through it and then realize I wasn't good enough to be in bands. And it was discouraging at first, but I was also a child, you know? Yeah.
And that's really like how you get, at least for me, that's how I got good, was playing with
totally.
Other people.
Then I got into a heavy metal band finally with dudes my age that I found in the suburbs of Atlanta. Mm. These were like little suburban dirt bags. And we had a band called Nightmare with a Y, and
of course,
and an umlaut,
yeah.
and
you couldn't figure out a way to get a Z in there too.
No, if it would have been called Nightmares, we would have had a Z at the end. But we definitely like did nothing but play our, that we were really basking in it then. It was the early '80s, and we were like super into. We were playing Kiss covers, Motley Crue covers, Def Leppard covers, Judas Priest, Iron Maiden, all that shit, Scorpions, anything we could fumble through and get through a song,
yeah,
we would. That's why Kiss was great, because the songs were pretty simple, and we could kind of get through them as a kid. So I'd say that was great about being an influence, was having the accessibility of something that we thought was cool,
oh, yeah,
but also not hard to play.
Though that was my first gig ever. It was my ninth grade talent show. We did Strutter and
there you go.
Rock
we did
and Roll
Strutter
all night.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah,
we did Firehouse and Ken had a Ibanez Destroyer, the guitar player, and he put fireworks inside the pickups.
Nice.
And all the strings broke off
because
it burned through them. But man, that never
happens when Ace Frehley does it.
Right,
what the fuck?
What the hell? And which later I'll tell you some funny full circle stories about that, because go figure, the road crew for Kiss all the way up through their reunion tours with all the original members in 96, 97 was my crew from when I moved to LA in 88.
Really?
In my first hair metal band.
Right. Okay, so you moved out here in 88.
I did. So cut to a little later, you
right.
know, I was playing in bands. I was trying to answer your question, but I went around the block to get across the street. I was definitely by 15 and 16 when I started to be able to drive. That changed everything.
Right.
So I found band members.
Now you're getting down to Atlanta.
Yeah, I'm going to Atlanta. And by 16, I'm playing clubs six nights a week.
Right.
In
Atlanta.
Was
there a big metal scene out there?
Yeah, it was all hair metal.
Right.
You know, by that time,
we're talking mid and late 80s.
Yeah. So, and also there was no original music scene in Georgia, in Atlanta even. Like you couldn't play in
really?
An original band. No, they only wanted to hire cover bands. You couldn't get a gig playing in an original band.
See,
anywhere.
You know what? This is a very interesting thing. This is always the advice I give to people. If I could go back and redo anything, I would have been in a cover band in high school. We were never in cover. I mean, we'd do the odd cover here and there. But it was always like, we got to play original music.
Yeah.
But that actually probably worked really well for you.
It was. It,
because you then you learn the craft of all these, you know, great songwriters, how they did their thing.
Yeah, totally. And so we kind of
people probably actually liked your band because you're playing songs that they know.
Well, yeah.
So like, here's this shitty thing that I wrote.
Yeah. So we played. And by the way, yeah, we were not good songwriters yet. So so when we'd sneak an original in, it would definitely be a bathroom break song. But we ended up moving out to... we finally moved out to LA.
Well, before all that, like, were you immediately like the lead guitar player, front man, songwriter in whatever bands you were
in? No, I
was
the guitar player, and we had a front man.
Singer, oh, okay. The band that you moved out to LA
mm-hmm.
with.
But, you know, before that, I'd played in the cover bands where I did sing a lot of the songs.
Right.
But I was always in cover bands that, like, that divided the vocals. Everybody like you know, if we had
a
girl keyboard
songs,
player, she
right.
would do Till Tuesday and Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I would sing the Def Leppard songs and I would sing and whatever. But then we would go to or Bryan Adams even, because that was actually my first song I ever sang live was Run to You off of the Reckless
nice.
album, which I still back that record.
That's Bryan Adams' solid greatest hits right there.
Oh, man.
Oh,
well,
man.
That album is all greatest hits.
Oh, is it really? Okay.
It's like seven singles off
right.
of that album
right.
alone. But yeah, I was really into that, because it was like, yet again, like, you know, not super hard to play.
Right.
it was good three chord rock and roll, and I could play it, and it was popular, so people liked it and knew it, you know. But yeah, we just basically played wherever we could get a gig. Then I ended up with a group of guys out of Rome, Georgia, which is where I was born and where my dad was from. And that was actually 40 minutes north of Cartersville, so it was even further from Atlanta. But it was a bigger city,
right?
And so I found kids there that were my age. There was this little rock scene of kids there that were all taking guitar lessons from this one guy who was he was incredible. And this guy would go on to be probably definitely top five like game changer influences for me in life was this guy Jerry King. Who, you know, when I wanted to learn more and I'd kind of gone through my stages of being self-taught after the guy in Cartersville, I kind of wanted to learn more and I wanted to be better. And my mom found this guy up there, and he was so passionate. He was a Berkeley grad who took in a whole crew of kids up in Rome, Georgia, where he lived, and just taught the shit out of them musically. Like, he was a ball buster. What's the movie?
Yes, about the drummer.
Yeah,
yeah, well, right.
It's that.
Going to jazz school or whatever.
Yes,
was it music school? Like, did you ever go to music school?
It was a house that was basically called King Brothers Music, and it was him and his brother, and so it was like a little private like learning school. And
that's interesting, because you don't play, like, whatever your sort of knowledge base of music theory and all that sort of stuff that you probably have, you don't play like a music school guy.
No.
Because, you know what I mean? That's like a real dividing line, I feel like,
yeah.
Especially with rock. I feel like guys that get a little too educated musically, not that there's anything wrong with it.
It's a bad move.
But it can shave off the rough edges a little too much.
Well, that's like I say, I think it's bad when a lot of producer/engineer types know too much technical shit, because it gets in the way of what you're trying to make, because half of rock and roll is mistakes.
Right.
And they're not wired for mistakes when they've trained their brain.
Right.
Like that. But you know, going back to Jerry, he was great because Jerry would teach everybody. We would do these rock guitar ensembles where he would put like eight kids together with a bass player and a drummer also the same age. And we'd go play concerts at the little auditorium in Rome and sell tickets and put on a little rock show. And we'd be playing... Allman Brothers covers and old 70s Santana covers and stuff like that, like where there's lots of guitar work.
Right.
And
stuff that's a little deeper than Dokken or whatever.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Like, because my guitar teacher was definitely a snob, you know?
Right.
But he appreciated the good guys. Like, he appreciated the Almonds and stuff like that and got me into all that. And so we're doing like Liz Reed and, you know, Melissa and all the, and Whipping Post and all this other shit. And it's great because I found my bandmates that I would end up moving to LA with through that circle. And so we ended up, you know, having our latest incarnation of our heavy metal band where we would go play six nights a week in Atlanta. And we even played six nights a week at this little converted Pizza Hut in Rome, Georgia, that was called Ronnie's Rock Cafe. I had my own set of keys to the place. I was 16 years old and 17 years old and had my own set of keys to a bar.
Amazing.
And we kept sleeping bags and mattresses under the drum riser so that whenever like we would go out partying, we'd go back there and just...
Were you not living at home anymore at this point?
Yeah, I was living at home, but like I was just gone. I was always gone because my parents gave me this incredible deal because they cared, believe me. My parents were not like these like passive, you know, liberal hippie types or anything like that. They were very, they were pretty strict, but at the same time, they had just raised two daughters and I was a pretty good kid. So they're like, hey, you keep your grades up and you can do this rock and roll thing.
How did you keep your grades up when you're doing six nights a week?
I don't know. My sleep was nothing. I would come in with like eyeliner running down my face and I had hair like down to my shoulders, below my shoulders. And I would be on 2 hours of sleep from playing the night before. And I'd managed to somehow get out of school with like an A average.
Really?
You know, yeah, I wasn't like college prep, but I was like, I'm not going to college. I already knew I was moving to LA the minute I graduated. My dad was like, because my dad didn't really do great in school. And he said, you know, you know, the deal we can make is I'll let you play in these bars and these clubs every night of the week as long as you go to school, don't fail, get and, you know, graduate. Like, don't quit. Please don't quit. You know, I think he just didn't want to see me, like, go down that path that he did.
Sure.
And, you know, he was kind of a troublemaker, my dad. But I said, that's a deal. And I kept it, and I did it.
Mm.
But I still had keys to the bar, and I still had sleeping bags under the drum riser, and we'd still go there and, like, take people back to the bar late at night and, like, just rage. And by the weekend, that was perfect, because by Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you know, I wouldn't even come home. I was just gone on the weekends.
Yeah, yeah.
I would stay up there. I'd sleep in the back of my truck on the baseball field a lot of times out there at Rome High School. And my buddy who was my guitar tech at the time, because
you had a guitar tech?
Yeah, because guess why? He had an alcoholic dad who, you know, who was just, I don't think he liked being at home that much, to be honest with him. He was a great guy, his dad, but like I think he just wanted to get away and kind of escape it. His mom died early on, and he was a great kid, this guy, John Cromer. Scary Larry is what I called him. And you know, he called me Bad. My real name is Brad, so he would call me Bad Brad, and I'd call him Scary Larry. We were just like teenage punks, like coming up with stupid names for each other. And I taught him how to string a guitar, because he was like, "Hey man, I want to help. Is there anything I can do to help? I don't know anything about guitars, but if I can help, I'd love to do it." And so I was like, "Okay, come help us load some gear. You can run the flash pot machine for the pyro, because we had homemade pyro boxes, and we blew the asbestos like drop ceiling out of Ronnie's Rock Cafe multiple times. I mean, I taught him how to string a guitar, and he would literally, like, we would go sleep in the back of my truck on the baseball fields on the weekends after playing shows and hanging out all night and partying with everybody in town. And, you know, it was very classic Friday Night Lights kind of vibes, you know, the town. But, he went on to be, he's the guy I'm talking about, went on to be Ace Frehley's guitar tech all through the reunion tour. He's like one of the most, he's probably
the
one
guy
of
that you taught how to be a guitar tech became Ace Frehley's guitar tech.
Yeah. He's one of the highest like paid techs in the country.
Great.
He's the one who redesigned all the mechanisms, all the pyro mechanisms for Ace's guitars on the new tours. He figured out a way to put mercury into the body cavity of the Les Pauls. I don't even know if I should be saying this, but this is great.
Is that good for you?
Well, no. Like, it was so that Ace wouldn't be fucked up and misfired into the crowd.
Oh, right,
it
had to be.
It would make sure it would not fire without the neck being up at a certain angle.
You're just crazy.
Thinking, there's all this like crazy like stuff. He patented a lot of the schematics for all this. He's insane. He's like, he's really, really incredible, and he's tech for everybody from Pearl Jam to you name it, like over the years. Whenever I was like, when my career went in the shitter, like in the 90s, he was like, he was killing it, and I was just, I'm so proud of that guy. And
So when did that band decide to move to LA?
Okay,
because you moved out in 88, so I mean, because I grew up in Southern California, I was going to shows in LA all through those years. So you moved out, you must have caught the tail end of the rock scene in LA, because I moved to LA from Santa Barbara in 90 with my rock and roll band. And rock was fucking dead.
Dead.
Like, it was that weird transitional post Guns N' Roses, pre Nirvana.
Yes.
Everybody wanted to be the Chili Peppers or Jane's Addiction or whatever.
That's right.
And nobody went to shows anymore. Because just a few years before that, shows were always packed out. Unsigned bands were selling out that country club and the rock scene and all that stuff.
That was us.
Okay, we caught some of that.
We were the last band standing, I feel like, in that scene. We might have gotten the last, like, bidding war record deal.
Really?
In that whole entire, like, wave of shit. I remember seeing...
How long were you out here before you got your record deal?
10 months.
Really?
It happened.
So you
really
must have
fast.
Felt like, I'm on my fucking way, man.
Well,
here's
what happened. Like, we moved out with nothing. Like, we literally were a cover band in Atlanta. We moved out and had four originals recorded that I did on a four-track. Because that's how I started recording, was I just learned how to record my bands on a Tascam four-track. And we ended up... making a four-song demo at my house, and recorded the drums out in the mill. My dad had a mill over the creek, and we shopped that around when we got out there to get gigs. And we ended up landing this guy Rich Bartle had a thing called No Bozos Jam.
Yes, at the Whiskey.
At the Whiskey.
Yeah, I played it many times.
Of course. So we
went. Great, because you could have no draw and play to a full room. It was amazing. It was like a 20-minute set, right?
It was awesome. 20 minutes, and we had to repeat our songs twice because we played them so fast, and we only had four songs. So we had to like play our songs like twice. And we played after 2 weeks of being out there, or 2 months or something. We had a gig, and we went and played it. And I remember we got written up in like all those like little Rock City News and LA as like tightest band on the strip. And it was like, what? No way. Like, you got to be kidding me. This is like where everybody's good. And we kind of realized that for lack of sounding, you know, a little bit, you know, pretentious, we realized that we probably worked a little harder than a lot of bands at our craft before we got out there. Because a lot of bands
bands didn't get to go to that rock school in Georgia that you were talking about.
And it was a lot of what we called all looks, no hooks.
Right.
It was like bands that couldn't write songs and they couldn't sing. And there was a lot of people with shit on tape. Like, that, you know, they were playing with tracks and
spending too much time at Long Hair Rocks.
Right.
And not enough time in the rehearsal
studio. Long Hair
studio.
Rocks. Yeah, exactly. Like, and that was, we realized that like, man, we're actually pretty good. Like, we were all like four part harmony, like we were a good band, but in a scene that was not considered that great,
right?
But at the time, I mean, it's all we knew, because we were, you know, we grew up in small towns, and that's what was killing on the radio at the time was fucking Bon Jovi and everything else, and so that's what we knew. Aerosmith, like, you know, they were having a huge resurgence, and Guns N' Roses, that was a big record for me. When I heard Guns N' Roses, that was like, okay, I need some spurs.
Right.
And I need to move to LA.
I need to be a kick-ass rock and roll cowboy, man.
That's right. I want to be a rock and roll cowboy, and I want to get off the bus with a piece of hay straw hanging out of my mouth, right, and I want to be welcomed to the jungle. And so we did, and we got there, and we ended up embracing the Sunset Strip full on 1988. Yeah. I was 17.
Mm.
We were out flyering every night for our shows on the Sunset. You know, it was basically you saw Decline Part 2.
Yeah.
I saw that on VHS. My friend had a bootleg of it when I was living in Cartersville in like 87, 88.
I'm going there, man.
I didn't even get the tragedy or the irony in it. I was like,
of course not.
I'm going to be those guys.
Yeah.
You know, and so I went out there full force with those guys, and we ended up starting to sell tickets on the Sunset Strip, because you know how that was, like, it was pay to play. It was very corrupt then. They would have five bands a night playing six nights a week, and every band had to sell all the tickets to fill the room, and then the headliner got paid.
Right.
And if you didn't
I wouldn't know that, because I was never in the headlining act.
Well, yeah. it took us a little bit to get there, but after about 6-7 months, the tide changed, and we started like filling the rooms, and then we didn't have to pay to play. We got to get paid a little bit, and we just all lived in a one bedroom, unair conditioned apartment in Hollywood, and had literally, there would be girls coming over to the house to like buy tickets, and they would like bring fast food over for us.
Right,
and
right.
It was weird. It was kind of a crazy like time, because I wasn't like some, you know, leech where I wanted to make it on our own, but that was just sort of like the way it was then. Yeah. It was weird. Yeah, the band guys were just kind of like just sloppy messes. And
with the stripper girlfriend paying
that took care of the band. It was such a cliche. But we ended up getting a lot of attention by a couple of labels, and then finally it all started.
You guys got a deal and everything?
Yeah, the wave hit, and we caught the wave, and it was the last wave ever. And we went in and did our record with, like, you know, big producer at the time, wrote a lot of it with the big writer guy at the time.
Did you learn a lot about songwriting at
I
that
did.
Point?
I did. Desmond Child, to be...
Oh, really? You wrote with Desmond Child?
That was my first experience ever.
Well, as a Kiss fan, you must have been beside yourself.
I was very happy because he had written some of my favorite jams at that time. And he was also on fire at that point.
Sure.
Like, it was just like everything from the new Alice Cooper resurgence was all him. Aerosmith resurgence was because of him. All those songs. And so I was like, this is my first like rock and roll boot camp as a kid.
Mm.
Getting a record deal, and the first record, I'm getting thrown into the lake of fire with this guy to learn how to actually write a hook, and he was great because he was ruthless and relentless.
What was his songwriting process like?
So we would go over, me and the singer, because I was just the guitar player, you know, in the band at this time. And we would go over to literally where we're at right now in Santa Monica at my studio. We are about five blocks from the house that we used to go to. And we would drive over to his mansion in Santa Monica, and there would just be like people cooking for him and you know, all this stuff. And it was just super elaborate and awesome. And we were just like, wow, this is amazing. Like, this is what it must be like. And so we would sit there, he would have a piano. I would play him an idea that I had. And Desmond was very cocky, very confident, and very brash. So he would just be like, that sucks. No, we're going to tear that apart and do this and that and this and that. I remember one time I had this idea, and I had this chorus idea, and it had love in it. Like, they said love in the title. And I remember I played it, and he just looked at me and goes, "What do you know about love? You're not even a person yet." You know, just shit like that. Right. And I'm like, oh my God. Like, I wanted to kill him, you know? Yeah, I was like, sure, this little redneck punk from Georgia at the time. All of us, we all talked like this back then. And, you know, it was like, we were just like such rednecks. But I learned a lot from him, and I realized that, well, he's right, for one. I don't know anything about that. I'd never had my heart broken, really. Like, I didn't know. Sure. I was a teenager.
Sure.
I had no idea what was about to come, you know, divorces and all that shit. So he definitely... He put us through the ringer, but you know, it was at the tail end, and we could see the writing on the wall.
What year was it when your record came out?
Finally, and of course, it was the major label thing where we got signed, and the record didn't come out for another like year and a half. So it was like 90.
So it's right on the brink. Things are bubbling up. The whole grunge thing is about to explode.
Oh, yeah.
It's already kind of happening. That sea change is already in the air.
Yeah. And I'm watching it happen before my eyes, and I'm watching it on MTV every day, and I'm watching coming to the realization that, okay, sink or swim. We got to adapt. We got to evolve. We got to move on. If I'm not going to just die in the water here.
Right.
You know, I've come too far as just a 20-year-old punk to like just go, nope, I'm going to stick with this dying scene, you know? So, but at the same time, I really enjoyed it. I was really glad that that other stuff came along, because as I started to grow musically, and a lot of people get pissed about this, especially old school, like, you know, metal fans, they get mad when a band that they like evolves or moves on or does something different. And it's like, you know, I'm really happy that I embraced other styles of music that were coming along, because I didn't know anything except what was on the radio and what was on MTV when I was a kid in Georgia.
Sure.
So when I moved out to LA and saw all this other underground music, not just hair metal, but like the punk rock scene, the sleaze rock scene, the alternative scene, you know, all this stuff was like bubbling up. And Then all of a sudden Seattle exploded, and that was incredible. I loved it, and I loved the music too. So I kind of realized that what I'd been doing all the way up to that point was about to be moot.
Right.
And we needed to like...
Well, isn't that funny though, how at that time, you know, through the 90s, after, you know, the grunge thing happened and all those bands became huge and heavy metal stuff kind of died out. You know, through that time, through the 90s, it was like the most uncool thing you could be associated with.
Absolutely.
Was like 80s butt rock heavy metal.
Without a doubt. You know what I
mean? But from this distance where we are now, it makes no difference at all. It's like a positive. Like, everybody's sort of forgotten that, which is great. Like,
it is really funny.
But you remember how that felt in those years. Like, pretended that, you know, you were never into that shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and that's the thing, is like when the internet came along, you definitely couldn't hide behind like some facade.
Right.
You couldn't say like, oh no, man, I only listened to like Beatles and Stones growing up.
You
know what I mean? Yeah. Like, fuck those guys. I mean, and a lot of times people think that the misnomer a lot of times, especially with old school fans, is that I look down on or don't embrace my past, but that's so not true.
Sure.
I just don't want to play that kind of music anymore.
Right.
But like, I really, really loved every minute of it until it became not fun.
Right.
And until I realized...
Well, so what happened with the band? Like, what?
Well, the band just, we toured. We just went full force. put the record out, did the video with the big dude who did all the Aerosmith videos, like, you know, the whole thing, Great White Hype, and then it didn't do anything. You know, I mean, not by the amount of money standards they put into it. I mean, you know,
sure.
Our video was on like Headbangers Ball every Saturday night at 2 a.m. which is not quite enough, you know, to recoup the millions of dollars they were putting into it. And then you realize also,
imagine a record industry that invested millions of dollars into records back then.
Well, crazy, right? And also just knowing that, like, man, a lot of this is not my responsibility.
Right.
A lot of this is resting on other people now and not us.
Mm.
And I was not cool with that. I was not comfortable with that. I really wanted this to be something where if we were responsible for our own fate.
Right.
And we weren't, because we were totally, you know, doing our dependency on them. Like, for
I talk about this
support.
All the time. There's a lot of middlemen between the artist and anybody in the public ever hearing your music.
Yeah. Well, it wasn't like after the internet and MySpace age came along, when you could literally go sell out your first show at the House of Blues and have 20 merch items and 3 songs.
Right.
And your band's never played a show before. Now, that actually fucking happened with a lot of those bands. Like, when that whole era, like when, you know, Fall Out Boy and all those bands emerged, emo, like a lot of those bands came out of nowhere just because of the kid network that was online.
Hmm.
Had nothing to do with the fact that they like went out there and toured their ass off for 20 years and built up a following.
Sure.
It happened like that for those bands. But not to say they didn't earn it later, because you have to still back it up and go out there and do the work. But the networking, the social network available on it to the world through the internet, and that world didn't exist back then.
Right.
So you were either dependent on a big producer with a big studio to make a good sounding record, and a big agent and a big manager to get you on big tours, and a record label to pay for the tour support to go do it.
Right.
That sucked.
Plus, with all the time, when you're talking about, you get signed and it's a year and a half until your record comes out. By that time, I saw this happen so many times to bands getting record deals, that the guy that signed you at the label would be gone.
Gone.
You know, like, that seems like that was like a very common thing.
You get shuffled.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
You no longer had a champion at whatever label you were on, and then you were just kind of lost in the thing.
Happened all the time. And so, you know, I think we just wanted to take matters into our own hands, because we realized what was great about the alternative scene that was coming up was a lot of it was it was DIY, and it was still pre-internet, but it was very DIY. Everybody was out doing shit themselves, making their own records.
Right.
And making their own merch and touring in vans. And, you know, we realized that, like, okay, we kind of jumped the gun here. We moved out to LA. 10 months later, we're signed. We're making a record in a big studio, and then they put us out in a tour bus with a light guy. Paying, we have a light guy, and we're like playing like clubs. Like, we're nobody.
Yeah, sure.
So it's like, that was exorbitant and stupid, but at the same time, it made us appreciate it when the rug was pulled out from under us and there was nothing left. You could either go, okay, that was that, I'm gonna go back to Cartersville and flip burgers. Or you could go, like, no, I got to do it on my own now. Nobody's going to wipe my ass.
But did that band, was it the same group of guys, or some of the same group of guys that evolved into Marvelous 3?
Yeah, me, the bass player, and the drummer.
Okay.
We went on, we actually, or the last straw was, we got offered this shitty deal to go play in China. Be the first American rock band to ever tour China.
Mm.
In 92, maybe?
Right.
And this was like our last ditch effort with our label, our second and last record as a band. And we went over and took the money because we thought it was going to be like Beatlemania or some shit, you know. And it was a disaster. It was one disaster after another for 6 weeks.
Oh, 6 weeks.
And to the point where
that's a long tour, man.
Yeah. Oh, and I could go off. This would take a whole other podcast of the stories I have from just how every day went over there. But like playing these big arenas to like people that spent their whole month salary, you know, for their families to come see an American rock band play, and they weren't allowed on the floor. We were in the middle of the floor, like playing in the round to everybody in the stands. They had to be seated. They couldn't stand. They couldn't cheer. There was, you know, machine guns all the way around the place, MPs everywhere. And then we finally, because it was communist country, they didn't want an insider riot. They didn't want the people to get out of hand. And on the last show, which was not supposed to be the last show, we were playing in this town called Jilin, and I'm sure I said like squirrel dick or something in Chinese just now. I'm sure I didn't say Jilin right. But we ended up playing this one show where we were just kind of over it and tired of the sterility of it. And so we kind of encouraged the audience to stand up and get nuts. And they were running on stage and trying to pull our hair out. And like, you know, guys and girls, like just trying to kiss us. And like, it was kind of our little strange micro Beatle moment,
right?
Like, where
people had, those folks had never, they probably didn't know what you even do at a rock concert.
And a riot ensued. And
they like, get the fuck out of our country.
We were rushed off the stage and into a van, and people were fighting in there. Like the cops were there going crazy. We got whisked off, and we're just young, dumb punks from Georgia just sitting there going, man, that was awesome. This is killer. Now, you know, now we're doing it.
Yeah.
And then the next day we woke up in our train car ride in Shanghai, or no, Beijing, at the airport, dropped off. No translator, no excuses, no managers, no nothing.
Just, it's done, go home,
go goodbye. Home, get the fuck out of here.
Right.
So they sent us home, and then they said that we didn't fulfill the contract by playing all the shows, so they didn't pay us.
No way.
And we're just kids, and we're broke. Like, and all of our gear was there, like, you know, that we had toured with in the States. We had $15,000 worth of cartage, you know, to get it freighted over there on a freight cargo plane. And we didn't know where it was. It was in the town 13 hours ago. And
did you ever get the gear back?
This is the best part of the story, is that guy I told you about, Scary Larry, John Cromer, tech extraordinaire now.
Yeah.
And Robert Long, who was also our bass tech at the time. Now he's like tour manager and production manager for Kiss for the last 10, 15 years.
Oh, wow.
And, same with, like, he's Kid Rock's guy. He's Motley Crue's guy. I mean, these guys couldn't be like bigger in the business now, but these were just kids that we met and that we took with us over there. And it was their first time ever on tour as well, these guys. They opted to stay behind and find our gear and get it home, those two kids. And they rode home on top of the road cases 15 hours in the cargo jet, in the cargo plane.
No way.
On top of the road cases to get it back to LA. They offered to do this.
I've had some great techs through over the years. I don't know that I've ever worked with anybody that's that dedicated to the cause.
No, well, it's because they had not had time to get jaded.
They weren't jaded yet, right?
They were young and hungry, and they were passionate, and we were a gang, you know.
Yeah.
We did everything together back then. So these guys were like, we're going to stay and find your gear, and we're going to get it home. I was like, that's insane. You know, I still look back on that and go, that's why those guys are where they are today.
Yeah, sure.
Is because they were not selfish and they cared. And that's what gave them the stripes to get to where they are now. And I couldn't be more proud of those guys. But, you know, we got back and the gear was held in customs because they sent it back COD. They didn't even pay for the shipping of the gear back.
Thanks, China.
Yeah, and we didn't have any money at all. We broke the band up while we were there.
Oh, really? So that was the
last straw.
Right.
So we broke the band up while we were there. It all fell apart. Me and Jace, the bass player, and Slug, the drummer, already had planned another band while we were there. I think we already had it named, and we're already writing songs on the train cars and everything for it. And they wanted me to be the singer.
Right.
So that was my first.
Was your singer sitting across from you on the train eating a bowl of noodles, just going, fuck you guys?
Pretty much, yeah. Yeah. He was over it. We were over it. It was kind of a done thing. But we weren't getting along very well, you know.
Well, those are hard. So, I mean, you know, when you, like, I've never had any kind of, been in that kind of circumstance on touring, although I've been in some weird, difficult ones. And that really brings out, like, you know.
You talk about, like, you're going to fight about the toothpaste cap being left off.
Right, yeah.
It's worse than any marriage.
Sure. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, it that's
guys
pretty
you
much,
love one minute, you want to fucking strangle the next.
Yeah,
and
not,
all that,
I mean,
shit, you know?
You know, you got to remember all the years we sat on top of each other in a one-bedroom apartment together and in a van and then touring and, you know, and it not really ending well. So, there was a lot of that and a lot of jealousy and a lot of inner turmoil with, like, girlfriends and, you know, it was every rock and roll cliche from every rock and roll cliche movie.
Now, throughout that time, are you sort of developing as the chief songwriter and the sort of the creative focal point of the band.
Well, this was where we finally realized we had to take matters into our own hands. And that's when we came back and we were able to save up the money. Our three dads took out $3,000 loans each to get our gear out of custom seizure at U.S. Customs at LAX.
Yeah.
And we got our gear back. And we ended up basically just putting our nose straight into the new band. And we went out.
Still in LA?
No, we moved back to Georgia.
Okay.
And we moved back. We lived in Atlanta, where I would go on to live for, 16 years. And come up, it was like a rebirth musically there. The town was on fire, musically, at this point. When we left, there was nothing.
Hmm.
When we left, all of a sudden, Black Crowes and all these other bands Collective Soul, all these bands started popping up that were Atlanta.
Yeah.
And we were like, wait, there's an original music scene in Atlanta.
Atlanta's the new Seattle.
Yeah. So we ended up going back there, and it was a great time to be in Atlanta in the 90s. It was a really great time. And so
were you also beginning to produce bands through that same time period?
Yeah, I was producing bands in my mom and dad's garage. I was living in Atlanta, but I didn't have a place to do it. So I set up a studio up in Cartersville in my dad's garage. And I did some bands. I would do bands demos for $200 a day whenever I wasn't on tour. Because I wasn't even making that kind of money on tour. We were in a van playing for $50 a night wherever we could get a gig for literally 250 shows a year everywhere we could play. And that was great. But to make a little extra money to afford paying rent somewhere, I would come home and had a 16-track recording set up, and I would record bands. I recorded this band's demos that got them signed called Seven Dust.
Oh, sure, yeah.
So I did their demos that got them signed. Then I did a couple other bands that went on to do well. And that started kind of getting me on the map as far as being able to produce stuff myself. So I would always produce my band's albums when we put them out. And then we would go literally to Kinko's and make the artwork, and it was very DIY, it was our own little scene of that happening.
Well, how do you go from that and coming from the sort of rock world that you came from and producing rock bands like Seven Dust and stuff, how do you go from that to segueing into working with these big giant pop artists? What's the bridge there?
So here's the timeline, I guess, was my band finally evolved into what would be known as a band called the Marvelous Three. And it was still the same three guys from back in the day. Since I was 15 years old, it was Slug and Jace and I. Mm. And so we were still very tight. We were still very good. We just finally stumbled upon a sound that was accidentally current, because we weren't ever trying to be current, ever. I didn't. Matter of fact, the irony is the only hit song we ever had is Marvelous Three was a song about selling out. The chorus was like, tell me I sold out, out, go ahead. And it was a song called Freak of the Week. And I remember I played that song for the local DJ at 99X in Atlanta, which was the station that you know very well. We had this demo basically of new jams, and there was a guy named Steve Craig there who had his own locals only show, who played all local Atlanta bands on Sunday nights. And I was like, I gotta, I want to start somewhere. And luckily Steve was a fan, so he would come see our shows when we play in Atlanta. We would sell out clubs in Atlanta when we weren't on the road, because we were starting to become a name around town and do really well, and known for our live show as well, because we were definitely a very energetic, fun show to see. And we were probably a little different. I like to say we were 5 years too early and 15 years too late, because we were wearing skinny ties and tight black jeans and eyeliner, and kind of look like the Ramones meets the Knack.
Sure.
It was it was way before, it was before bands were wearing eyeliner and skinny ties for sure. But it was definitely, we were definitely a couple of years before that. And but I think it was weird enough that labels were like, the fuck is wrong with you guys? You guys don't look like Limp Bizkit.
Right.
You guys don't, where are your JNCOs? We weren't into that at all. And plus we were already a little older. So we were already 27, maybe around this time, 28. So we had already been through a record deal, but nobody really knew that, because the internet was not really a thing yet. So nobody knew, nobody even made the connection that we were in some like dying hair metal band,
right? Sure.
From back then. So we had a full reinvention stylistically, but we also had 10 years in between to evolve naturally right. into this. And Steve Craig was a fan. I would take him, or I took him to his cubicle at 99X to play him this new stuff. And he heard like 30 seconds of that song Freak of the Week. And he literally made a bold move that would kind of, that would be a big pivotal career point for me, was he got up and he goes, follow me. And he literally walked in and interrupted Leslie Fram, the program director.
Oh yeah, I know Leslie.
Who was having a meeting in her office, and interrupted and said, do you have 5 minutes to listen to this? Which I was like, at the time I was like, holy shit, that's
what
like,
what are you doing?
What are you doing? You're going to get me in trouble. She's going to hate me.
Plus, there's nothing worse than playing somebody your demo and being there with them while they listen
that's
to
right.
it.
That's right.
It's like the worst feeling in the world.
And she was on fire. She had just like broken a couple of acts like that other stations followed and yeah. like made like huge hits. And she was on the cover of all those like Billboard magazine type
right,
things,
right, yeah.
trades mags and all that. And I knew about her, but I'd never met her. And I'd heard she was a real cool girl and that she was really, really, you know, into championing things.
Mm.
And, So it was cool because she was like, hey, yeah, you know, I know a lot of the other bands in town that have been speaking very highly of you guys, and I'd love to hear it. And so, you know, she played a couple of songs, and the ones I really wanted her to hear, which were not the songs that you would hear on the radio, but songs that, a dumb musician would be like, listen to this. It's got
this
killer
is the
guitar.
Best one.
Yeah. And then he played her that song, Freak of the Week, and after the chorus, after like a minute, she stopped it and goes, that's a hit song. She's like, that's a hit song, and I'm gonna start playing it. And I was like, please don't be lying with me. Don't be fucking
don't break my heart.
I was like, because I was literally living on someone's couch at that time.
Yeah.
And you know, basically just like house squatting, and had a car with three wheels on it, and you know, a pot to piss in, and touring 250 days a year, still broke as a joke, and labels didn't want nothing to do with us. And she said,
she's going to start playing it, but this is a demo that you haven't even put out yet.
That's right. And she was like, don't sign anything with anybody yet. You know, she was very confident that this would get us. Well, because people were turning us down, and then all of a sudden she started playing it and the phones lit up.
Sure. Of course.
Stations all around the country started adding it. And then all of a sudden labels that turned us down 2 weeks earlier were offering us blank checks for a record deal. And so, you know, case in point, right place at the right time, but put in the 10,000 hours, I guess. And so I went in and we finished the record. It was funny because that's the song that I didn't even care about. I was like, yeah, whatever with that song. But, you know, there must have been something there, you know, that
people connected
grabbed
to.
People. And it goes back to the Stay Gold thing, because it was definitely a song for the outcasts. You know, it was a song about like being a total, you know, a geek and like selling out, and then all of a sudden having to deal with that and coming to terms with fame, which I didn't even know anything about yet. I didn't even know I'd ever even have a chance to like have any success. And so I definitely wrote it third person, you know.
Sure.
And then next thing you know, we're it's all happening again. We have a video. With a big director, we make the record. The video's getting played on MTV.
You're like, we are not going to China this time.
We're not
boys.
Going to China, and so we did the whole thing again. Next thing, we're out on the road again, playing shows and festivals everywhere, and yet again, it was a quick ride because this was at the also unfortunate time where nu metal was king, and. You know, program directors and radio station, you know, DJs and stuff kind of hated us. I could tell a lot of them would look at us and go like...
That was a macho time in modern rock.
It was
rock.
So macho. It was so like, almost like, also a little bit caveman.
Right. I just remember like, you know, that was right when I joined Foo Fighters. I joined Foo Fighters in 99. And so like
right,
all the festivals that we were
playing...
And
you guys
playing,
were heavy enough though, you could like get through.
Just barely.
You were heavy enough
we were
you
definitely
could get
like the
through,
odd man
like,
out at a lot of those festivals.
Yeah,
though.
The guy, the DJ with the weird beard and the braided beard would probably still love your band
sure.
because, you know, you played right along Godsmack and were better, you know, or you played right along like, you know, Limp Bizkit, but you guys had, you know, you had, your songs had the balls and it had the teeth and that we didn't have that. Our band was a way more romantic sounding and way more, like literally kind of sounded like the band, the Romantics, you know, we were like way more power pop almost. Sure. And, but we were too rock for like the Eve Six and the Semisonic and all those bands that were like more like the, I don't know what to call those bands, but it's definitely was, I feel like those guys were a lot smarter than me. And yeah,
what do
more
you
intellectual.
Call those bands? Because that was definitely a subgenre of alternative rock
like,
or whatever at
like,
that point.
Yeah, like thinking man's
right.
rock. I don't know, but we were a little bit, we were kind of like in between the caveman and the thinking man. Like the lyrics were smart, but we had tattoos and put on a rock show.
Yeah, yeah.
But, so it was weird, a weird time for a band like us. And there, you know, we were just trying to fit into a round hole as a square peg, and it just clearly imploded again. And from there, you know, I just never looked back. I was like, you know, we put in the time after being in a band together for 15 years and hardly ever seeing anybody but the three of us.
But being a guy, do you think that being a guy with, you know, clear like pop sensibility in your writing and in the music that you made was what led other bands to go like, I want to work with that guy as a producer.
Yes.
I want that guy to help me put my songs
and sorry,
together.
I totally diverted again from your question.
Oh, it's all good. That's
which,
all good.
Which was, how did that lead to me producing other people? Well, when that got signed, when Freak of the Week blew up and people started, labels started dishing around and looking for producers and even co-writers for their newly signed acts, they would look at whatever was popular at the time on the radio, and that song had a moment at alternative radio, and so people would call up and go like, who produced your record? And I go, oh, I did it myself in my bedroom. Who engineered it? Oh, I did. You know, who wrote it? I did. And so then all of a sudden,
you're hired.
Yeah, and then certain, all of a sudden, I had people coming to me going, can you do that for this band?
Right.
Can you write that? Can you do a song like that for our band, blah, 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 over here? And so next thing you know, I'm just starting to get calls to do it based on, I guess, my own work with my own band.
And do you write with a lot of the bands that you wind up producing and a lot of the pop artists and stuff?
I do, but I don't, it's not something I force. Like, I don't ever, like, if the song is good, I'm not going to just go like, okay, I'm an asshole, I'm going to get half your publishing because I can.
Right.
So I'm going to change one word. I don't do that.
Right.
Like, I mean, to me, it's like I like producing stuff and not even touching it if it's a great song. I'd rather just be the producer on it. But a lot of times I'm having to come up with the song from scratch with some people.
Right.
So it's just a case by case, and it's really what the artist wants.
Right.
You know, I mean, some people are open to it and some people are not very comfortable with it.
Do you ever have the situation, you know, like I'm a huge boxing fan, and there's been plenty of instances where elite level boxers try to become trainers and that doesn't work because what came very easy and natural to them is hard to explain to, so they don't know how to teach it to somebody. So did you ever have that situation with artists you're working with where there's a frustration that they can't do the thing that you're hearing in your head?
Sometimes, but I gotta say that being from both sides of the fence, like still being a musician and a touring artist and making records, it definitely keeps me, it keeps both sides well oiled. Like it keeps my muscle flexed on how to produce and also how to be an artist. So when I'm working with an artist, I know how they're thinking, because I'm not just like some guy that, like, you know, was a A&R guy who turned into a producer and has never been in bands and doesn't know the dynamic and the fragility of some of these people's egos and brains and insecurities.
Well, there's so many different production styles. Like what's your thing in the studio? Like, how do you do it?
Well, I guess a lot of my idols growing up weren't necessarily all the same type of producer. Like I loved Rick Rubin growing up because I thought he was a visionary. He really wasn't a technical guy, like, per se. I don't think he really turned a lot of knobs on stuff. He had people doing it for him.
And he's like not a musician.
He's like the band shrink.
Right. Isn't he the guy that comes in and goes like, I like that one and that one. And the
yeah,
rest of them
he's
are
like,
no
this
good.
Sounds
Do
orange.
More of that.
This sounds purple. Make it all sound orange.
Right.
You know, he's that guy. And then I think that's all artists, like all artists, basically. And I do love that. And that's a big part of it. And also being also not scared to tackle genres and be like, oh, I can produce the shit out of this Johnny Cash record. I can also produce the shit out of this Slayer record.
Right.
And maybe this Dixie Chicks record.
Sure.
And you know what? That's one thing I can't stand more than anything is closed-minded fucking people that think you are only one thing and can only do one thing. You're
well,
not
clearly,
accepted.
If you look at the list of people
yeah.
that you've worked with over the years and like, you know, Taylor Swift to...
Yeah, it's all
Urban,
over the place because
the Weezer,
of,
whatever, you know, yeah. it runs the gamut of a lot of different things.
I'll never compare myself to Rick Rubin, but I definitely think he set up the template for being able to be, you know, a producer, a well-rounded producer of all genres.
Right.
Because he was a music lover growing up, so he identified with all those kinds of music. It's not that he's going, oh, I'm just going to have fun and try a country record. I've never listened to a country song ever.
Right.
He has. He's
sure.
listened to everything.
Yeah, of
And
course.
That's me. I'm a music junkie. So growing up on all that different shit that MTV was playing in the early years and the radio only having like three stations, you listened to everything and you appreciated everything. So
yeah.
I think that kind of came with the territory for me was like that. But I also was also more hands-on musically because I dabbled in all instruments.
Right.
And I also... was my own engineer growing up, so I learned how to record and get sounds myself. I learned all the miking techniques, and I learned what sounded good with what and what didn't. And so I think just soaking all that up. I didn't mention Prince, but I should because he's probably one of my biggest influences ever, even though musically you would never hear it. But I grew up like a massive Prince fan.
Mm.
That was one of the things that like you could be a metalhead and love Prince in 1984.
Right.
You could be a punker.
Because he ripped.
You could be a country star or a country fan and love Prince. That's pretty much the respect level was unanimous because he wrote it all, he produced it all, he played it all, he put bands together and like wrote all their songs and was their visual, you know, stylist. And it was just
sure.
like all these things were like that intrigued me. So I think coming at it from my rock and roll school, I wanted to apply that same thing as a producer. And so that's why when I go in and work with somebody, it's all a case by case thing. Sometimes it might be getting in a room with somebody and there's no songs and we got to write all of them together. Sometimes it's people coming in with a full thing and they just need a fifth wheel or, you know, and maybe a different opinion to come
right.
in and go like, I'm going to be objective about
unbiased,
this and that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I feel like it's all case by case. And that kind of makes me, love the job more because I'll never get tired of it because there's so many facets. There's so many different ways to come at it from a different angle. When you can work with all kinds of artists.
Have you ever had somebody else produce you?
Yeah.
Which, like, you know, in recent years, like with your solo stuff, do you ever hire somebody to be your
yeah,
sounding board?
Every once in a while, I need some clarity and I need some perspective and I need to learn something.
Mm.
And I think you don't learn anything just like sitting in your own bubble and this is just how I do it. Nope,
right.
you're gonna play the drums and then we're gonna put the bass on it and then we're gonna put the guitars on it, left and right, blah, blah, blah. Nope, that's just how I do it. That's not me. I would rather be inspired constantly by other people's work and learn tricks and learn things from them. And that I feel like that'll keep you around longer doing,
right.
you know, what you do. And you know, when I started out, I learned a lot of what to do and what not to do by working with producers early on. And by the time The Marvelous Three came around and I did our last record, I did the first one, co-produced it with a buddy of mine, Jim Ebert, who taught me a ton.
Mm.
He was I really liked working with him. He was like kind of like a, you know, we shared the same love for you know, power pop and things like that. And so I learned a lot about recording techniques from him. And then I did another record where the last Marvelous 3 record I co-produced with Jerry Finn.
Oh, wow.
And I learned so much from Jerry. We were the same age. We became like super best buddies during that time. And that's when I really learned a lot of the technical side because I felt like Jerry was way more of a, he was way more of the technical end. Like he was, he would sit there and shoot out mic cables and batteries and, you know, guitar pickups and amplifiers and all this stuff. And like, you know, phase correlation and all this stuff that I just would throw under the bus and go like, fuck it, I just want to record it. Like, you know, I had more of a
press record.
I had more of a like Keith Richards approach to things, like, you know, before that. And then I learned just enough from him to not drive me crazy, because I'm still not like OCD that way. I still like to just get it and go. I'm very in the moment. Whereas Jerry, it was like you had to take your time and everything was like nothing happened fast. So
that was a real shame. I didn't know him personally, but I was a big fan of a lot of his records.
Me too.
And through that era, I mean, I think he made some of the best records of rock or whatever through that era.
He was known at that time for doing all the Blink-182 and the Green Day records and Rancid.
But like he made that great Super Smoking Drag. Pope's record.
Smoking Pope's, Super Drag.
Yeah, Super Drag. Oh, that record he had just done
that record, Head Tripping Every Key.
Yeah.
And it was on the same label I was on. And it didn't even, I don't think it came out officially, because everything was about the A&R guy, every song.
And, right.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. It was brutal.
Yeah.
And it was awesome.
Yeah.
And I wanted to work with Jerry because of that record.
Yeah.
And I just remember, you know, that was one of those moments where I graduated as a better player, better producer, better engineer, just by taking in a lot of his school of thought and applying it to my way of doing things, which was a little bit more off the cuff and a little bit more spontaneous and whatever. So it helped shape going through those, you know, those years of making records for people. And I made a lot of them from the time I made that record to now. I made a lot of those records with a lot of things I learned from him. And just recently, like in 2014, I think, my dad died a few years ago, and we were really tight. We were really good friends and really close. And he was my biggest supporter, even through those dark 90s era where I was couch surfing and didn't have a lot of people in my corner, but I had him in my corner, and we never had money. So it's not like I had financial support, but when he had 20 bucks, he gave me 20 bucks. And you know, I still remember one of my favorite moments was not having a pot to piss in, but I would go down to this music store and trade gear all the time. And one of the guys there had an old Volvo station wagon, 1980 station wagon with like 300,000 miles on it, sitting in the parking lot. And I was like, what's the deal with that? I didn't have a car. And all I had was the beat up band van. And they were like, oh yeah, it's been there forever. Like if you can start it, you can have it.
Really?
For $100.
Right.
I didn't even have $100 in my name. I had 80. And I charged the battery up, fired it up. It fired up first time. And I drove the wheels off that car until I ever made any money at music where I could buy my own real car. But my dad gave me the 20 bucks extra to buy that car and put a new tire on it. And, you know, we were just good friends and He was very proud of my tenacity throughout the years of sticking to my guns, even if it meant that he was always the one saying, you got to pick your shit up and just keep going, man. You got to keep charging forward. He'd always say, you throw enough shit up against walls, eventually it's going to stick, you know? And it was that kind of encouragement that I didn't understand at the time, but it was so invaluable to me because we didn't have that connection when I was a teenager. You know, he was going through a midlife crisis and his mom was dying and he was not into the rock and roll thing I was doing. I think he was worried I was just going to become a slacker, drug addict, loser, you know, typical what you would think a musician is from a small town dad.
Yeah, yeah.
And so to see that respect grow after I moved away from home and like grow and grow and grow, to where he was just like, oh, you know, you got this, you got this. He was my biggest cheerleader. So when he died a few years ago, you know, I was really spun out and kind of at a point where I was like, I'd written all these songs about him and didn't really know how to go about recording them and what I wanted to do and how I wanted to do it and if I wanted to do it. I was really emotionally kind of depleted. And so I had been corresponding with my friend Ryan Adams at the time. And actually, I had been talking to him about making one of his records.
Ah.
About producing one of his records. And it never came to fruition. We, you know, my dad died. I went off the radar.
That makes sense. So it seems like you guys would be like kindred spirits musically.
We are, and we in a lot of ways we are. And I was big fan of all his records, and he said he was a big fan of mine. So it was like we had a common love there. That after my pops died, though, I buried my head in the sand. He went and made the record of his, and then I ran into him in New York later and was like, hey, I was like, hey, I got these songs and I'd love to play them for you. I just want to get your opinion. So he came to my hotel room and I was playing them on acoustic, and he immediately like just started like ripping into them. Like, he's very opinionated, which I love. And I needed, because I'm not used to that. I was always used to just my own thing, and my own shit didn't stink. And I just always answered to myself. Sure. So I always made my records myself. And he's like, no, you got to change the key. I don't believe that lyric when you sing it in that key, blah, blah, blah. It was like things I'd never been told before.
Mm.
And it was kind of coming at it from a songwriter, not a producer.
Right.
And I needed that. And so he, I learned a lot in that 1 hour. And then he started rewriting lyrics and stuff on the spot. And I was like, whoa, like, what are you doing?
Get out of my song.
Get out of my song. Yeah. And he ended up, but he was right.
Right.
And it was beautiful. And I got on the plane. I was riding back on the plane going, shit, man, this is, I need to have him do my record. And so I texted him from the plane and was like, do you want to produce this record? And he was like, yeah, let's do it. And so went in the studio with him when we organized it, and 4 days later had this record called Afraid of Ghosts.
Oh, so he produced that record?
He produced Afraid of Ghosts.
Right.
And that was 2 records ago for me.
Sure.
Yeah. And it was great, because I literally went in it. I had come out of the fog of my dad's death so, like, I want to say carefree, that I just was like, I don't care what happens. Just produce me. Tell me what to do. I've never said that.
Right.
And I was like, I didn't even show up with a guitar. Nothing. I would ride my motorcycle there every day. I'd just pick any guitar off the wall. We had his band. It's all set up live to tape. And I would just, and we'd work up a song, and then we'd record it first, maybe second take always. And that would be it. And
it's a great way to make a record.
It is. It's fun. And that's how I grew up making records. And I was like, this is great. And I would just say, okay, what do you think? You tell me, man, you're the boss. You're the boss, man. And I loved it, because I had this like immense sense of freedom that I'd never had before.
Are you less nitpicky with your own stuff than say you would be producing like a Katy Perry record, where it's got to fit
enough,
into
no.
this very super
no.
pop world?
No, because that's the funny thing is, when I work with somebody else, I know exactly what I want and I know how to get it. I know that sounds cocky, but I fucking know. I put in the work and I know. I already know how the song sounds in my head, and I know how to make it sound like that when it's recorded. Whether or not the artist agrees with me, we have to come to some sort of terms there, because it is a committee. I'm not like a dictator. I'm not trying to get my way. But records go pretty smooth when the artist trusts me.
Right.
And I do my thing. And but when I'm doing it for myself, I can't get out of my own way, just like most people can.
Mm.
And although I've made my records all in a way quicker amount of time than I ever made anyone else's, because... And mainly that's because of the convenience factor.
Right.
Because I'm not sitting there translating it to an engineer or anything. I'm not going, what'd you think? Oh, okay, I don't know. Punch me in there, blah, blah.
Do you play all the stuff on your own?
Yeah, I do, mostly. But I'll have like a drummer play on it or something like that. But but like on the last couple of records I've done, it was more of a band thing, which I loved.
Cool.
And that actually was, that was really, really rewarding to come out of that four-day process with an album done that I was never going to question. We didn't even revisit the songs. After we recorded them, we never listened to playback. we never played it back because we didn't want to start tearing it apart.
Right.
We wanted to go, did that give us goosebumps when we played it? Then don't fucking question the bumps,
then that's
man.
A take.
Don't question the goosebumps.
Yeah.
Keep it. And we would never hear it again until time to mix. And we didn't even mix it. It was the board mixes. We just used the board mixes. And, you know, I remember my manager was asking me for instrumentals for, you know, for like syncs.
Sync licenses, all that, yeah.
And I was like, if you take the guitar out, there's no vocal. If you take the vocal out, there's no guitar. Because, like, literally I was, like, playing live at the same time.
Right.
And, you know, it was like one of those things you couldn't do that on records back in the day.
Yeah, sure.
So, anyway, that being said, the last record I did, Ryan and I kind of conversed over it a little bit for Stay Gold. And he was still there. He was still present in like, pitching some opinions on the aesthetic of the record and things like that. We were both like just kind of figuring out like what's the next move, because it didn't work out timing wise for him to produce my record and I needed to do it in this certain amount of time,
right?
Which is another reason why my records get done quicker. It's because I have a window very small to make my own shit, because I'm making everybody else's records.
And I was going to ask you about that. Like, I imagine you're at a point in your career, and have been for quite a while, where you're approached all the time about producing all kinds of people.
Yeah,
and you have a family, and you have a solo career, and God knows what other interests as well. So how do you sort of pick and choose who you're going to work with, and when you're going to slot in your own time to be an artist and do your own thing?
You know, I never really plan it out that far in advance. It just kind of like lines itself up miraculously every year, where I can go in and make, I'm never going to make a record unless I've got the songs.
Right.
Because I will never, at 47 years old with gray hair, the last thing anybody needs to hear from me is a fucking phoned in record.
Right.
I'm not going to make a phoned in record.
Are you in here all this, like, are you a studio rat? Are you in here? If you're not making somebody's record, are you tweaking on your own songs?
Yeah. I'm here 5 days a week.
Right.
You know? I spend my weekends at home with my family and riding motorcycles and whatever, but like I'm a committer. Like I like to commit to something whenever I record it. If I get the moment, I don't obsess over it too much. But when it comes to my own stuff, like I said, I it's nice to have perspective from other people sometimes, but making other people's records, I think, getting back to your question, I really just want to work on stuff that seems like, these days, it used to be more about making things out of necessity and making a living and taking a record because, oh, you should really work with this artist because there's a lot of heat on them and you'd be regretting it if you don't, and it's a good paycheck. And I'm very fortunate right now where the paycheck has been steady for years, and I now can do it based on whether or not it's something that would be fun.
Mm.
And I need it to be fun because life is too short and it's getting shorter.
Yeah.
And I don't want to die of a heart attack or die of a brain aneurysm like Jerry Finn did right in the middle of his, like, a massive, amazing pinnacle of his career, doing what he loved, but died too soon.
Yeah.
And the lesson there is, like, I would rather just make records that I love. And I don't care who that artist is or what kind of music it is. There's good and bad. I say this all the time, but there's good and bad music in every genre. And if I can do as much of the good stuff in all the genres as I can, and if it's a fun challenge and a fun project, and then that's everything. Like I can work on, like, you could be Radiohead, and if you were Dickheads, I wouldn't want to work on the record. And by the way, they may be. I've heard stories, but like I'm saying, like, life's too short to get in the studio and like just like fight and deal with egos and deal with people that will never get outside their box and never get outside their comfort zone and
sure.
And overanalyze and obsess so much that they just kill the vibe. Like I don't want that. Like I want things to be fresh and keep moving. And you don't always get that. And by the way, that's okay. That's work. That's called work. And I'm okay that I have a job where
Sometimes making an album, I mean, it kind of is, you know, probably better than just about anybody, it can bring out the best in people, and it can bring out the absolute worst in people as well, because it's
like
such,
alcohol.
Totally, like, because it's such a, you know, humbling, and you know you're so vulnerable so much of the time, until you find, you know, there's always that period where you're trying to like work a part out, and you're really, you know, we're all kind of insecure inside, you know?
I know,
and
I
that's
know.
Tough. That's when the that's when shitty things happen and shitty arguments happen in the studio, you
that's
know
right.
It can be very tough,
and you know, you guys have probably gotten the bugs worked out over a few years, where, you know, you've got a good, you've got a dream team where, like, you guys still work with Nick?
We have, it's not for a while, but yeah, I mean, he's still
a he's
good
a bud.
Friend. Oh yeah,
sure. I love Rascal Lennox. Yeah, he's great. But that, and like, you know, you've worked, you Butch Vig, and like that, you guys have worked with people that, you know, it's going to produce positive results.
Sure.
And the vibe is going to be good.
Yeah.
That's so important. When you're making records. And I think I just found over time my stable of people that I like to call on and work on in the studio, that more importantly, there's going to be a lot of good vibes and a lot of laughing and a lot of unspoken decisions and chemistry that is going to be made.
Yeah.
Because we know each other so well.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's nice to get in a room with people that you've never met before and hash it out and go like, oh, fuck, we're flying without a net. This is going great, though. And, you know, I mean, that's the beauty of making records, is you just never know what you're going to get.
Well, there's nothing better than that feeling of going into the studio in the morning and not knowing what's going to happen and leaving later that night with like a finished song.
And that's the way I try to treat everything in the studio, is like we usually treat it like, you know, let's get a song done in a day.
Yeah.
Maybe 2 days, but like let's shoot for everything. Let's leave with a Christmas present.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, you know what I mean? And I think that's so rewarding and so fun to do. And, you know, every now and again, one of those songs does well for you and you get to reap the benefits of your work. And I guess it's kind of like golf. I wouldn't know. I don't play it, but like, I guess it's kind of like golf, where it's like, once you get a hole in one, you're addicted. And once you get like that good shot, you're finally in.
See, that's my problem. I never got that hole in one.
Yeah. Or even just like getting it anywhere near the hole, right. You know, like just like, that's the same thing musically. Like when you like, when you shoot and you get it, that's an addiction into itself,
sure.
You know, into
sure,
itself,
sure.
Where you can just like be in the studio going, God, I can't believe we just made this.
Totally.
That's really cool. And I want to do it again tomorrow, you know?
Yes, that's the magic of recording.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, cool, man. Thank you so much for hanging and doing this with me.
Yeah, thanks for having
Appreciate
me, man.
It.
Appreciate it.
Sometimes people play a song. If you feel like it, go for it. And if you don't, that's totally cool, too.
Oh.
It's entirely up to you. I probably should have told you that in advance.
Yeah. I mean, dude, I can do a song if you want. Okay. What are we going to do here? Let's do, let me try, I'll do this one. Do you care if it's like something mellow?
No, that's great.
Cool. Here, you know what? If I can be a producer.
Yes, absolutely.
Let's move this.
This is what's great about.
Perfect. Yeah, I gotcha.
You want to move this around?
This is perfect.
Okay.
If I fuck it up, I'll start over.
There you go.
Lyrically. This is called Record Store. I drove through two states you hate to make sure you're alright. You're beautiful, but you look like hell standing in this light. Got a glass full of hours before roadie picks you up and takes you back. I can't call you by that stage name, you're still the girl I know. They hate her wearing dresses, they love the radio. Do you still bite your lip till it bleeds every time that you get sad? Meet me at the record store, even though it ain't here anymore. more. Sing to you that song about time moving on. Wanna love like I loved you when I could. Came from white trash, whiplash, road rash from a bike. You drink from a wine glass, stage pass, in your belt loop tied. Little baby made it out of here when ambition was the only drug you tried. You got your chain smoking, soft spoken, housebroken man. So you won't be lonely, all because you can. When you tell me things are perfect, your hand starts to tremble when you lie. Meet me at the record store, even though it ain't here anymore. My God, it's been so long. What the hell went wrong? Wanna love like I loved you when I could. Believed in, let you walk a wire without a net. I cried a thousand nights for you when I could feel your pain. Those times the bottom fell through like a dog left in the rain. Oh, love sick and loaded, come on, let's go back to where we met. Meet me at the record store, even though it ain't here anymore. Fumble through that song, make you hum along. Gonna love like I love you when I could. I just struggle to remember the lyrics. But
you are clearly a man that spends a lot of time in the studio.
Yeah, that was Butch Walker on Walkin' the Floor doing an exclusive acoustic version of Record Store off his latest record, Stay Gold. All right, I looked on his website. He doesn't have any tour dates coming up, so I don't know what Butch is up to. Go to butchwalker.com and you can find out for yourself. You can also find him on Twitter at Butch Walker. That's it for this week. Make sure you go listen to all the old interviews in the iTunes store. Leave us a rating, leave us a review. We love you. I don't know where I'm going to be next week when I tape this thing, but I'll be somewhere on the continent enjoying the touring life. This is Chris Shiflett for Walking the Floor. Adios, amigos!